start. Hare Krishna, everyone. Start now. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Prabhuji, can you hear me?
Yes, Madhaji, please continue.
Okay. Om Ajnanatam Rindasya Gyananjana Salakaya Chakshur Unmilitam Yena Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha Sri Chaitanya Manovistam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Sri Guru Sri Yuta Patakamalam Sri Gurum Vaishnavam Cha Sri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunatham Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Sarvabhutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Sri Radha Krishna Padan Saha Gunalalita Sri Vishaka Vishaka Vitamscha He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dina Bandhu Jagatpate Gopesa Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namastute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneswari Prasavano Stute Devi Paramami Hari Priye Vanchakalpatruvyascha Kirpa Sindhu Eva Cha Patitanam Pavanevyo Vaishnavevyo Namo Namaha Om Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhara Sripa Sadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare Hare. Thank you, Prabhuji.
Thank you, Mataji. Very nicely and sweetly chanted.
Welcome,
okay.
Prabhu.
Now I would like to invite Ishwar Prabhuji, Dr. Ishwar Singh from Rohtak, senior vocalist. Prabhuji, please, can you recap the previous class, which was based on mantra number 16 for all the group?
Thank you, Prabhuji, for one more opportunity. And Hare Krishna to all devotees. The task assigned to me this evening is to recapitulate and summarize mantra 16 of Sri Shopanishad. But before I formally take up the specific subject, I would like to go back a bit, take a little detour and say that and recount how much ground we have covered so far. See, we have a goal, we have an objective to reach up to. And to know Ishvara, the absolute truth, the supreme personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna. Anurag Prabhu has been very, very generous with our tutorials on scriptures. In Sri Shopanishad only, if you see, he has taken us to the last section, which contains mantra 15, 16, 17 and 18. Which exhorts and signifies the art of praying. And the prayer is to Ishvara to reveal himself. Meanwhile, Prabhuji has been laboring very hard with us to fine-tune and clarify the various themes and nuances of earlier four sections. We got to know how to live in harmony with Ishvara, how to develop spiritual vision, how to differentiate right and wrong vidya, how to do right and wrong worship. And this has enabled us to take the final call of praying and pleasing the God Almighty. At this stage, I would like to extrapolate this feature with one of the very important metaphor which Prabhuji taught some time back, the metaphor of three-story house and a staircase. Say, in this context, I would say Prabhuji has led us to that house, that three-story house, which is visible to us. We are assembled in the ground floor, the first floor of first story, we can say. He has fed us, he has fed us with its details as to what is and where and what it takes us to stair, to use the staircase of for reaching to the topmost story. Our objective we have started with. So with this little detour of words, I would like to now take up my subject of recapitulating mantra 16. Essentially, this part, the last section of Sri Ishopanishad, deals with fervent praying and beseeching the Lord to take the devotee beyond the blinding white light, the theme of mantra 15 and 16, and through, besides this blind light, we also pray that he should take us through all the obstacles of conditioned life as well, which is the theme, combined theme of mantra 17, 18 that we are going to study now. This is to reach, so as to reach the Supreme Person, the Bhagwan form. So that is our ultimate goal, because from that beginning, we can make a real dent to meet our Bhagwan. If we wish to put it more succinctly, then these prayers to the absolute truth culminate in devotional service leading to God realization. So also we have known while studying mantra 15 of this section that how Bhagwan is the manifestation of absolute truth. And the same has been understood more profoundly, distinctly, and more clearly while studying mantra 16 in detail. While looking into the details of mantra 16, to decipher the word meaning, the basics of mantra 16, it becomes amply clear to the devotee that the Lord is maintainer, philosopher, regulator of principles, devotion of devotees, and a well-wisher of the progenitors of mankind. With this understanding, with folded and extended hands and kneeling down, we beg the most auspicious form of bliss to remove the effulgence of transcendental rays, to be able to discern the eternal Lord in person. And this is not unusual, knowing one, just like sun rays are part and parcel of the sun. Qualitatively, our relationship is the same. A similarity of narrative also follows if we translate the mantra 16. Now, taking into cognizance of these facts, the word meanings and translations, we broadly assume that mantra 16 is a continuation of prayer in mantra 15. The Lord is a personality being addressed as philosopher and maintainer, etc. We have accepted the personal form of the Lord. His form is most auspicious and confidential, Kalyanatam, as we say, and is much like a devotee qualitatively. We meet that criteria of quality with him, just as sun and sun rays meet that quality. The impersonal seekers, on the other hand, they just feel little good about this relationship, but they ultimately fail to defend in final analysis. Now, with this background, we now move on to learn how Srila Prabhupada has gone on to understand the themes of mantra 16. And in paragraph 1 and 2, which is highlighted by a word, Vyuha Rashmin, which means beyond Brahman is Bhagwan, it stands proved that Vaishnava view carries more credence by being in full understanding, that is of Sat, Chit, and Ananda. The impersonalist view is at best a partial understanding of absolute truth. A final blow to their philosophy has been duly delivered through an explanation of Brahma Jyoti in Brahma Samhita, which says, unless one surpasses the glare of Brahma Jyoti, one cannot know about the land of the Lord, nor the factual abode of the Lord, nor the transcendental form of the Lord. So it is absolutely impossible for impersonalists to know that. They are just trying in vain, hence worthy of rejection. Moving on to paragraph 4 and 6, 3 and 4, where the word kalyatmam, kalyanatam is supreme, which means Bhagwan is the most auspicious realization of, as indicated by this word kalyanatam. The Bhagwan aspect, form of the Lord, is the highest destination. It is the best aspect that ensures being in loving relationship with eternal and complete satisfaction of love. He helps the devotee by bestowing his grace, by bestowing his mercy through bhakti yoga, the devotional service. Though this bhakti yoga is difficult and it's very rare for people to achieve such success, but certainly it's difficult, but not, it's definitely successful also. And Gita has given enough evidence of this. If you read Bhagavad Gita chapter 8, chapter 9, and chapter 17, there are verses 14, 13, and 19 which clearly support this view. And the mercy of Lord thereby comes through knowledge, engaging in service of the Lord to get the taste of bhakti. And as we do seva to the Lord, we are bound to get meva, the mercy of the Lord. And with so doing, we can really see the Lord, even talk to him face to face. Furthermore, by seeing the etymological explanation of Bhagwan, we also come to the same view. If we divide the Bhagwan word into Bha, Ga, and Van, we find it representing as the maintainer, the guardian, our guide, leader, or creator, all in one. The transcendental sound of Bhagwan represents the infinite knowledge, potency, energy, opulence, strength, and influence, all without a tinge of inebriety. Moving on to paragraph 5, which highlights Pushan, which means how the Lord maintains the devotees and others. He does it by being a true guide, a true leader, a creator, a merciful boss, and original cause of all causes. And also, he satisfies the lording propensity of jivas, the all types of jivas, whether they are devotees or non-devotees. In paragraph 6 and 7, Prabhupada mentions soham ashmi, which means how is living entity are one yet different. He brings in two words, soham to the soham. Soham means we are same as God qualitatively. Also, we are similar in having controlling propensity, as the Lord is also having the controlling propensity. Dashoham, on the other hand, means we are servant of the Lord. We are different from the Lord quantitatively. We are being controlled by him, and we are definitely subordinate to him through laws of material nature. In the final analysis, there is no denying the fact that soham understanding alone is faulty, as no relationship of any kind or bhakti or love is possible by this. Whereas the soham understanding is complete, as relationship and loving sentiments are possible and worth attempting. Moving on to the last paragraph, where Prabhupada says, favor of the Lord sought by this prayer, as we see in mantra 16, culminates in bhakti, as evidenced by mentions in Gita chapter 10. Verse 8, 9, and 10 and 11. The pair Kali Yuga as evidenced by in the Gita. Favor sought to reveal the most auspicious form facilitates the understanding that Lord is the source of Brahman and Paramatma, and emergence of bhakti is a natural corollary which furthers the cause of collective glorification of the Lord through Sharvanam and Kirtan, and finally helps the devotee from inside to reach him and salvage him from the agony of cyclic births and deaths, which is the real goal of us devotees. Thank you so much. I have tried to be as close to reality as possible, but if I have made some omissions, impertinence of any kind, that may be looked into and clarified by your goodness. Thank you so much. Thank you all for patient hearing.
Thank you very much, Prabhuji. It was very, very smooth, very brilliant, excellent presentation of the class summary. In fact, poetic also at times, I could sense that. And you have used a lot of your realization to write that and express that in the class. I was very, very joyful when I was hearing your presentation. So thank you very much. That was very nice.
Thank you.
Okay, so with that nice summary of the previous class, we will move to our today's subject, which is based on mantra number 17. And the topic or the theme that we will cover in mantra 17 today is how devotional service help us passing the exam of death. So let us get into this subject in today's class. The picture that you see on this slide is actually Bhishma Dev lying on the bed of arrows close to his death, where he's actually instructing the Pandavas. And Lord Bhishma Dev was one of the very exalted devotees of the Lord. And he got a very glorious death, glorious passing away from this mortal world, because Lord Krishna himself was present before him and so on. So I thought this would be a very apt picture to convey the mood of how devotional service help us passing the exam of death. But let us understand a little bit more about it in the class today. So this is the overview map, and I recall Dr. Ishwar Prabhu in the beginning of the class, before summarizing the previous mantra 16, also connected us with the whole Ishopanishad. And the way he connected us with the complete subject matter of Ishopanishad was very, very nice. I would like to repeat a little bit on the same theme, and specifically would like to connect mantra 15 to 18 to the larger body of Ishopanishad that we have studied so far. And the reason I'm doing so, because I realize that the class might be finding the discussion on mantra 15, 16, and so on, maybe a little challenging. So first of all, we need to have a bigger picture understanding of how mantra 15, 16, 17, 18, the last section of Ishopanishad actually connects with the whole book. So far, we have covered several themes in Ishopanishad, but how is mantra 15 to 18 are connected with this, the previous themes that we have read. So, so we will start with the first section, where we understood about the importance of living in harmony with the Ishvara. So Ishvara means the controller, the supreme controller. So the supreme Lord is the supreme controller, and we should know how to live in harmony with the Ishvara for our own benefit, for our own happiness. We should know how to live in harmony with the Ishvara. That was the theme of the first section, starting from invocation till mantra number 3. Then, how do we understand Ishvara? How do we, after we understand who is Ishvara, he is the supreme controller, how should we live it? How do we understand and how do we develop the spiritual vision to know Ishvara? That was something which we covered in mantra number 4 till 8. Then in mantra number 9 to 11, we also need to know how to differentiate between the right and the wrong knowledge to know Ishvara. So after developing that spiritual vision, where we discussed mainly about qualitatively we are same, but quantitatively we are different, those kind of subjects we discussed in mantra 4 to 8. But in mantra 9 to 11, we also wanted to understand what is the wrong understanding of Ishvara and what is the right understanding of Ishvara. Similarly, in order to, after getting this knowledge of right and wrong vidya about Ishvara, then we progress further about the right and wrong worship of Ishvara. If we don't understand Ishvara properly, or if we start to understand the wrong way of worship Ishvara, then our efforts will not be successful. We will achieve something else rather than achieving Ishvara. So that was the fourth theme. To know Ishvara, we should know right and wrong worship. But in the end, now here comes the connection with the last section. So we can know, we can have the spiritual vision, we can have the right vidya, we can have the understanding of what is the right worship, what is the way of right worship for Ishvara. But all that is an effort on our part. All that is an endeavor on our part. We should also understand that we cannot know Ishvara unless there is the mercy aspect of Ishvara is satisfied. So mercy means unless God himself wants to reveal himself to us, we cannot know him. So that is why mantra 15 to 18 are actually prayers. These are prayers by the devotee. These are prayers by the practitioner who is praying to the Lord to kindly reveal himself to the devotee, to kindly give that understanding of God, give that understanding of Ishvara to the devotee, so that the devotee can actually understand Ishvara and can reach him, can actually attain him. Now, what is the difference between mantra 15 and mantra 16? So in mantra 15, we see that the prayer is all about that, please remove this effulgent covering and I want to see your face. That's what the prayer is. So in mantra 15, there is a prayer to know the a more confidential aspect of Ishvara. And that is why we enter into the debate about the impersonal aspect and the personal aspect. Because the mantra talks about remove that bright effulgent white light so that I can see your face, mukham. Now, when we say that remove that bright effulgence and beyond that bright effulgence is your face, is your personal aspect. So we concluded from mantra 15 that actually the personal aspect is the most confidential aspect of the Ishvara, not the impersonal aspect, which is the Brahma Jyoti or the white light. So that was in mantra 15, where we are praying to the Lord to show his most confidential aspect. Then in mantra 16, there is an additional information. So it is a continuation of the same prayer in mantra 15, where the practitioner is still praying to the Lord to show or to remove that bright effulgence. But here in mantra number 16, there is an additional aspect of the relationship. Relationship means here in mantra 16, there are three important sub-themes. One is we see that the word used is Kalyanatama. Kalyanatama means most auspicious. And then the Kalyanatama word is used in relationship with the form of the Lord. So Tejo Yat Te Rupam Kalyanatamam Tat. So Rupam Kalyanatamam. So here in mantra 16, the aspect is that the Rupa or the form of the Lord is the most auspicious. And we also discussed that how Kalyanatama is the superlative degree. Kalyan, Kalyanatar, Kalyanatama. Like good, better, best. So it is best, Kalyanatama. So Kalyanatama has come along with Rupa. So same theme in mantra 15, where the prayer is about removing the effulgence to see the face. Here also Kalyanatama means that the face or the personal aspect is the most auspicious. Then the second sub theme is Soham. Soham actually means like me, like you. I am like you. So aham. Like you are, Soham, so I am like you. So that is something which the impersonalists take this word soham and elaborate on this word soham, that I myself and the God, Jiva and God are actually same. And then they go even beyond that, okay, we can become God. Like that, they kind of take that concept of soham. But from this mantra number 16, we understand that Bhagwan or the Rupam is the Kalyanatama, is the most auspicious form. And soham actually is qualitatively oneness, qualitative oneness. And that too, in the last part of the of this mantra, where it is talking about, is giving this analogy of sun and sun rays. So like Ishwar Prabhu also mentioned in his presentation, that sun and sun rays, they are qualitatively same, but quantitatively it is quite different. Sun is very, very hot, and beyond sun also there is sun god, deity of sun. And sun rays, as it travels, it actually has the potency of the, qualitatively it gives light and heat, but the potency or the quantitatively the magnitude of heat and magnitude of light actually continues to decrease. So Jiva, living entities, compared to the sun rays, and sun god or sun deity of sun is actually compared to the Bhagwan aspect of the Lord. So the point is, mantra 15 talks about the confidential aspect of the Lord, to know the Lord, to know the most confidential aspect. But in mantra 16, the relationship is also there. Relationship, it means that we are subordinate to the Lord, and the Lord is actually the supreme controller. So mantra 15 establishes the confidential aspect, which is the personal form, and mantra 16 tells us that we have a relationship with that personal form, and we are subordinate. We are actually part and parcel of that personal form. So that is why these are the prayers to Ishvara to reveal himself in mantra 15 to 18. And like we say, in mantra 15 to 16, we are talking mainly about going beyond the personal white light to the supreme person. And in mantra 7 to 18, we will talk about, take me through all the obstacles of conditioned life to you. So it is again a prayer. So in the 16th mantra, it is more about the relationship. Now in mantra number 17, we will today discuss that it is about a prayer to the Lord, kindly remember my services, kindly remember my seva, whatever seva I have done throughout my life, kindly remember. And this body is actually temporary, and I want to give up this body, but please remember my seva so that I can come to you. That is the prayer. So it goes a little more deeper. The prayer now becomes a more intense, a little more personal. The devotee is not talking about ending his life, or it's not talking about suicide in that sense, but ending means life. It's talking about his own death, and death as a very important milestone. He's requesting the Lord that after this milestone of death, I please kindly have mercy on me, and kindly remember whatever I have, small or little, I have done for you, so that I don't once again have to come back to this mortal world of birth and death. I probably come to you, but for that I need your mercy. And that is the prayer, mantra 17. So let us look at this prayer in detail. So mantra 17, the prayer goes like this. वायुर अनिलम अमृतम अथेदम भस्मांतम शरीरम ओम क्रतो स्मरा कृतम स्मरा क्रतो स्मरा कृतम स्मरा. So it's a very beautiful rhyming verse. Let us look at the meaning of each of the line one by one. वायुर अनिलम अमृतम. वायुर means life air or pranavayu, or in short sometimes we also call it as prana. So vayur anilam. Anilam means the totality of air. Amritam. Amritam means which is indestructible. So this material world, we see there are five gross elements. So these five gross elements are actually indestructible, like law of conservation of mass or law of conservation of energy. So they are indestructible. But there is a pranavayu which is connected with the jiva. But there is a vayu element outside also, which is indestructible. So let the air of life, so that the living entity is praying, let the air of life be merged with the totality of air. And then in the second line, he's saying, athedam bhasmantam shariram. And let the temporary body be burned to ashes. Bhasmantam. Bhasma means ashes. Sharira is body. And this body, let this temporary body be burned to ashes. And then, Om Krito Smara Kritam Smara Krito Smara Kritam Smara. So the lines are almost repeating two times. Om Krito. Here the word Krito is actually referring to the Supreme Lord. So two times the word Krito has come. So one time the word Krito actually means the enjoyer of all the sacrifices. And the second time the word Krito comes, it is about enjoyer. The first time it is about enjoyer of the sacrifices, and the second time it is about the supreme beneficiary. O enjoyer of the sacrifice and ultimate beneficiary. So the word Krito has two meanings here. In the first line, it is enjoyer of the sacrifice, and the second line, it is ultimate beneficiary. Then Smara. Smara means remember. Please remember. Kritam. Now, Kritam here is about the services, the seva, or the activities that the devotee or the practitioner has done. So, O Lord, enjoyer of sacrifice and ultimate beneficiary, please remember all my sacrifices. Please remember all that I have done for you. So, Kritam here is his sacrifices, and the second Kritam also actually means sacrifices, but Prabhupada has translated all that I have done for you. So here you can see that this is a very intense prayer. This is now the devotee is not, now the devotee is becoming a little personal to the Lord. So you can see in mantra number 16, after having that understanding of the relationship with the Lord, now the practitioner is praying much more intensely, much more fervently. He's talking now about the end of his life. He's talking about the death milestone in the life. And by reminding the Lord that, so through this prayer, he's reminding that this body is temporary and the body has to one day end. And then there is an eagerness to meet the Lord. And in that eagerness, the devotee is fervently begging for the mercy of the Lord, and he's kind of reminding the Lord that I have tried something for you. I have done something for you in this life. Please remember that something, whatever little, whatever insignificant I might have done in this life, kindly remember that. So that is how this mantra actually now goes. So here we can see that through this prayer, we also understand one thing, that spirituality actually is a serious business. The purpose of spirituality is not to simply have some cosmetic addition to our life. Like, for example, we say that when we want to glorify our life, when we want to say that we are living a very good life, sometimes we try to count our blessings. For example, we can say, I have a very good car. I have a very good house. I have a very good wife. I have a very good family. And I also have a very good guru, like that. Or we go to work. We have a nice house. We have a nice family and so on. And we also go to temple. So it is not something, spirituality is not something a part-time pursuit. It is not something like a cosmetic pursuit in our life. It is actually something, a very serious business. And how serious this business is, you can understand from this verse. In this verse, the practitioner actually is talking about remembering the Lord, asking the Lord, praying the Lord to remember his services, so that when he ends this life, he doesn't have to take birth again. Actually, he's not directly mentioning anything about taking birth again or not. But why would this devotee actually pray to the Lord to remember his services? Because of some reason. In the previous mantra, we saw that he's already asking the Lord to reveal the face. So he is actually looking forward to meet the Lord after this, after the end of this life. So in this verse also, there is another aspect which we would like to discuss here. And sometimes some devotee might have this question also when we read this verse. It is about, why would a devotee want the Lord to remember his services? The Lord actually doesn't need to be reminded. He knows whatever we have done. Without even reminding, he already knows. He's situated in our heart as Paramatma. He's always looking towards us. He's aware of all the activities, all our thoughts, 24/7. He's always aware. So there is no need for us or for the devotee or for the practitioner to remind the Lord. So acharyas actually explain, and this way to prayer like this, that please remember whatever I have done, is not something which is a best of the prayers. If we want to understand the prayers at a pure devotional level, maybe we can look at the prayers of some other devotees which are mentioned in Bhagavatam, like Kunti Maharani or Vritrasur and so on. But Upanishads in general may not always talk about at the pure devotional level. So still it is okay to request the Lord to kindly remember what I have done. But the acharyas have explained that this is not the best of prayers to offer. Best of prayers could have been that, how can I more serve you in my next life? Something like that. So, but the point here is that we need to look spirituality in a much more serious way. And why we should look at spirituality in a much more serious way? Because it is related with one of the most important milestone in our life, which is our death. And after that milestone, it is decided that where are we going to go as our next destination? What is our next destination going to be? So death is a very serious milestone. And in order to prepare for that milestone, we have to start our effort throughout the life. We have to start our effort right now so that we can actually do our best when that milestone is in front of us. So we need to look our death with gravity. And when we look with some seriousness, and when we look with that milestone with some seriousness, we will be actually feeling motivated enough. We should be able to feel the urgency enough to prepare for that time when we are going to transcend from one body to our next life. So with that, let us now go a little more detailed into the analysis. We will look quickly onto the various word meanings of Mantra 17. So Vayur, air of life, or in Sanskrit, we can call it Pranavayu or simply Prana. Anilam is totality of air. Kruto actually, as I was mentioning, has two meanings, enjoyer of sacrifices and supreme beneficiary. And Smara is remember. It is not difficult. Smaran is also a word in Hindi. So remember. And Kritam means whatever sacrifices I have done, whatever seva I have done for you, O Lord. So that is what the various word meanings here. So now the translation, as Srila Prabhupada has translated this, we'll quickly read it. Let the temporary body be burned to ashes, and let the air of life be merged with totality of air. Now, O my Lord, please remember all my sacrifices. And because you are the ultimate beneficiary, please remember all that I have done for you. So the broad understanding of Mantra 17, already we have discussed several points, but let us quickly capture here. It is again a prayer to the Lord. And this prayer is mainly referring to at the time of death, which is a important milestone. And the consciousness of the praying person, the person who is praying, he's actually at this time, he's fully aware of his past deeds. At the moment of death, he's aware of his past deeds, whatever I have done, because he's reminding the Lord, please see whatever I have done for you. And then why he's reminding? Because he has his eyes set on the ultimate goal. This particular person who is praying this, he understands that body is temporary. That is why he's talking about that the pranavayu merge into the totality of air and my body be burned to ashes. So he's fully aware that the body is temporary and what is eternal, although it is not mentioned in the verse directly, but it is very clear that he's eyeing something else. He's sighing something more eternal. That is the ultimate goal. That is the lotus feet of the Supreme Lord. And then what are the intentions of the jiva here? The intention of the jiva is that we transcend this body and enter the spiritual kingdom. And how he's trying to achieve that? He's trying to achieve that by reminding the Lord in a mood of prayer that, oh Lord, kindly be merciful on me and don't let me fall once again into this trap of old age, birth, death and disease. Kindly remember whatever little services I have done, whatever some sacrifices I have done, and be merciful to me. Because if you are merciful, then even if my sacrifices are not sufficient, my services are not sufficient, because of your mercy, I will probably be successful. So that is the mood of this mantra. Now we will once again analyze this mantra based on the explanation given in the purport by Srila Prabhupada. And this is a rather a long purport with 15 paragraphs. And I have once again divided each of these, all the purport into several themes here. You can see there are 7 primary themes. So because this mantra talks about the temporary nature of the body, it also talks about death. It also talks about the thought at the time of death, what would be the thought at the time of death. And it talks about, it actually does not directly talks about the ultimate goal, but in the purport, Srila Prabhupada is mentioning about what should be the best possible goal for a devotee and so on. So along those lines, the whole purport has been divided here, you can see. So paragraph 1-3 will talk about the temporary nature of the material body. This is simply a dress. And this dress has to be given up. And then in paragraph 4-5, Prabhupada talks about what is the best way to give up this body. We have to reject this body one day in our life. But what would be the best way to reject and give up this body? So the answer he gives is by surrendering to the Lord, not by going to the Brahma Jyoti. Now, we have already discussed that in elaborate detail in the previous mantra, in mantra 16 and mantra 15, that Bhagwan aspect, the personal aspect is the most confidential aspect. And the impersonal aspect, which is the white, bright effulgence, is the impersonal aspect, which is the subordinate aspect. So the best way is to go to the Lord. And how we can go? By surrendering to the Lord and not by going to the Brahma Jyoti. Then it talks about last thoughts. At the time of death, our thoughts, our consciousness is very important. And he talks about how can we develop that consciousness. So in paragraph 8-9, because in this verse, the practitioner or the person who is praying, he's talking about, please remember my services. So Prabhupada has taken up that point and mentioned in the purport that Lord does not forget our services anytime. Lord is very, very merciful. And he's specifically merciful to his devotees. And we will give some references from Bhagavad Gita to explain how Lord is very merciful. And he never forgets his devotee. Devotee might forget him at the time of death because of some situation, because of some emergency or because of some difficult situation. But the Lord never forgets his devotee. Then in paragraph 10-11, it is mentioned, Prabhupada mentions that Krishna's mercy is always available through devotional service. So he's talking about the various processes of devotional services in paragraph 10-11. And in paragraph 12, Prabhupada mentions that whatever is the theme of this mantra actually has been elaborately expanded in Srimad Bhagavatam. And we will see how it is elaborately expanded in Srimad Bhagavatam. And then in mantra in paragraph 13-15, we should learn to prepare for death by practicing pure devotional service. So like that, the whole concept of this mantra has been divided into 7 themes in the purport by Srila Prabhupada. And let us now look into each of these themes one by one. So we can see here, So paragraph 1 to 3, Srila Prabhupada starts the description by telling that this material body is simply a dress which needs to be given up. And he starts in each of these paragraphs, in 3 paragraphs, he says that mantra 17 confirms that body is temporary and living entity exists after its annihilation. That is why this person is praying in this mantra. So he is saying that let the body be burned to ashes and please remember my deeds. And why would he say so? Because he's acknowledging that the Lord, you are the supreme beneficiary. You are the enjoyer of all sacrifices. So please remember. And why should you remember? Because I just don't want to come back to this material world again. I just want to come back to you. Then after explaining that the body is temporary, Prabhupada further goes on to explain that in this material world, there are varieties of bodies available. Like we go to a cloth shop, and when we go to a cloth shop, we have different dresses available, different colorful dresses. And not only we may have t-shirts, we may have shirts, we may have maybe pullovers, we may have coats, and so on. Maybe we may have swimming dress, we may have under garments, and so on. So various varieties of bodies are available in the storehouse of the material nature. And how are these material bodies assigned? These material bodies are assigned based on our desires. And Srila Prabhupada in his purport give an example, couple of examples. For example, he says that a person who likes to eat meat, who likes to eat non-vegetarian food, the material nature understands and acknowledges that desire. And in the next life, he may get a body of a tiger, because tiger is carnivorous, always he's looking for flesh. Or there are various other species of animals who are always looking for eating flesh. So the material nature recognizes the desire of the living entity, and in the next life gives a befitting body to fulfill that desire. So our bodies are given to us because of our past life desires, and they are given to us to fulfill those desires in the present life. And he also gives an example of stool. Like this animal, pig or hog, it likes to eat stool. So people who are very fond of eating filthy food, rotten food, stale food, all kind of dirty food stuff, if they are willing to eat like that, then the material nature once again acknowledges and gives a befitting body of a hog or a pig. Okay, you like to eat filthy things? Please enjoy in the next life by getting this body of a pig like that. So then further he explains that perfection is when we give up the body and enter into a spiritual atmosphere. So he's trying to explain that we get a lot of bodies, or one may get different type of bodies depending upon the desire. But the ultimate perfection is that when we don't have to get another body in the next life. The perfection is when we actually enter into the spiritual atmosphere and leave behind this temporary material atmosphere. And in the next life, when we enter into the spiritual atmosphere, we are full of happiness, we are full of bliss. So we don't have to do with this temporary business. We have to be more focused, be more attached to the permanent thing, which is the spiritual atmosphere, the spiritual world, or the permanent abode of the Lord. So like that, Srila Prabhupada has started and warm up the discussion in his purport by explaining once again, by referring from Bhagavad Gita and other books like that, that this material body is a dress which is to be given up, and the best way to give up this body is to enter into the spiritual atmosphere. Then next, we would also like to discuss a little bit about 3 different attitudes that people will have towards body. Now, when we are talking about the temporary nature of body, so in the scriptures here, it might be a good idea to pause a little bit and talk about what are the different attitudes of people towards their bodies. So these are three different attitudes. People may romanticize their body, people may demonize their body, and people actually may utilize their body in the right way. So let us understand each of these. When we say people may romanticize their body, what does it mean? That people want to use their body for full indulgence. People want to use their body for sense gratification only. Khao, piyo, maja karo. Eat, drink, and be merry. And this philosophy is something of materialism. And who is the main philosopher of materialism? Is the Charvak Muni. So Charvak Muni, he used to say that yavat jivan sukham jivet, rinam kritva ghritam pibet, bhasmi bhutasya dehasya punaragamamam utaha. So what he's trying to say here is, yavat jivan sukham jivet. Whatever time you'll want to live, live happily, live peacefully. And what is the what you should do to live peacefully and happily? Rinam kritva ghritam pibet. Even if you want for living peacefully, for living satisfactorily, for living happily, even if you have to beg, borrow, or steal, don't worry about it. Rinam kritva, borrow money, and ghritam pibet. Ghritam means ghee, which is clarified butter. Rinam kritva ghritam pibet. Bhasmi bhutasya dehasya means that after this deha, after this body has been burned to ashes, bhasmi means ashes. Punar agamanam matlab, punar agamanam means there will not be next time or there will not be any next life that you will come back again. So what he's trying to say is that till what time you want to live, live happily, live peacefully. Even you have to borrow money, but borrow money and live nice, live life king size. Yeah. Who knows after this body is gone, who knows whether you come back or not? Nobody knows. So this is the philosophy of materialist. So you can see in Vedic philosophy, you will find those philosophers also, which are materialist in nature. And if you remember in from our Ramayana class, when Lord Ramachandra and Bharat were having this dialogue and Bharat was persuading Lord Ramachandra to return back to Ayodhya, one of his ministers, Jabali, also presented this philosophy of materialism to Lord Ramachandra. So this philosophy of materialism, you can find its glimpses in the Vedic literature every now and then. The second aspect or the second attitude is to demonize. Demonize means when people look towards body as a trap, something filled with stool, blood, pus, something which is abominous, something which has to be hated, something which has to be rejected, like that. So that is the second aspect. And second type of attitude you can see towards bodies. And the example of this we can find in Srimad Bhagavatam. In Srimad Bhagavatam, there is a story about Pururava. He was a king, but he was rejected by this heavenly damsel Urvashi. When Pururava gets rejected by Urvashi, he started to realize that this body actually is a bag of stool, pus, bones, and all kind of abominable stuff. And he tries to, through his prayers, through his realization, he tries to develop hatred towards the body. So that is another aspect. So one is romanticize, which is one extreme. And the second extreme is demonize, which is considering that the body is a trap. So devotees actually are somewhere in between. They neither romanticize the body and they neither demonize the body. They actually utilize the body. Utilize the body means they engage the body. They understand this body actually is a trap. Certainly it is because of my past misdeeds I have got this body. But let me make the best bargain. Let me make the best deal out of this bad bargain. I have got this body, which is a bad bargain. But Now I do not engage this body in those activities that further aggravate this bad bargain. Rather, I should engage myself in those activities which make the best out of this bad bargain. And what the devotee does is, devotee tries to engage this body in the service of the Lord. And the example for that we get from, once again, from Srimad Bhagavatam, where we see the prayers of Ambarish Maharaj. So Ambarish Maharaj prays in Srimad Bhagavatam that Savai Manah Krishna Padar Vindayo, may my mind be engaged in the lotus feet of the Lord. Like that, in his prayers, he identifies each of his limbs and identifies a service for each of this limb. For example, he says that let the eyes be used to have the darshan of the Lord. Let the legs be used to walk towards the temple of the Lord where we can have darshan of the Lord. Let the nose be used to smell the flowers offered to the lotus feet of the Lord. Like that, Ambarish Maharaj is glorifying each of the limb of the body only when it is engaged in a proper devotional service of the Lord. So we have three different attitudes. The Karmis or the materialists have this attitude of romanticizing the body. Those who are somewhere on the Jnani level, or maybe somewhere who are trying to really reject the world, they demonize the body. They look the body as a trap. But the devotees actually try to utilize the body. They try to utilize or engage the body in the service of the Lord. So we also see in Srimad Bhagavad Gita how Arjuna was trying to exhibit this kind of a mood. We see some glimpses of romanticization, demonization and utilization in Bhagavad Gita itself. So romanticization, where do we get that? So where Lord Krishna is actually talking to Arjuna that if you win this battle, you will enjoy the kingdom. That is something which is a materialistic way of encouraging a person. Like we saw that three-story house metaphor. So this is the story one level kind of a understanding, which is romanticizing that if you win this war, you will enjoy the kingdom. So this is romanticizing. Then the third thing is demonizing. Demonizing is where Arjuna himself is talking about leaving the battle. Let me not kill my relatives. Let me go to the forest. Let me actually not care about my own glorification. Let me not care about my own benefit, own pleasure in the future. That is where he is trying to demonize. He's trying to reject these worldly pleasures. He just want to go away and leave the battle and go on to forest. That is something which is kind of parallel with the demonizing the body. But ultimately, after he hears Srimad Bhagavad Gita, he understands that the best course of action actually is utilize this body in the service of the Lord. And the will of the Lord is that I should fight this battle and I should utilize this service. I should utilize this body. I should utilize my skill in service of the Lord and let not get distracted by some of my petty weaknesses. That is the affection of my relatives and so on and so forth. So we can see that how Bhagavad Gita also conveys this fact of romanticizing, demonizing and utilizing. Now moving to the second theme of the purport, which is paragraph 4-5. Best way to give up the body. Surrender to the Lord, not by entering Brahma Jyoti. Here Srila Prabhupada once again uses Srimad Bhagavad Gita to explain that what is the best way to give up the body. And he develops the purports in a way that first of all, he establishes that only in human form, we can cultivate spiritual knowledge. We cannot cultivate spiritual knowledge in any animal form or any other form. For example, we don't see in animal societies that there is a temple or there is a practice of observing fast or there's a practice of observing any worship. We don't see anywhere in the animal kingdom. So only in the human form, we can cultivate spiritual knowledge. But even those who cultivate spiritual knowledge, only few attain perfection. Like in Bhagavad Gita, Lord says, Manushyanam sahasreshu kaschid yatati siddhaye. among many, many thousands of human beings, only few desire to become perfect. And then among those who desire to become perfect, only very few actually know Krishna in truth. That is also is mentioned in verse number 77.3. Those who achieve perfection, hardly one knows Krishna. 7.3. Let me read that second line for you in verse number 7.3. So here, yatatam api siddhanam kaschin mam veti tatvata. So among the siddhas, yatatam api siddhanam kaschin mam veti tatvata. Only among the siddhas also, only few actually knows me tatvatah. Only few knows me in truth. And then in 7.19, we understand that those who know Krishna in truth, who are cultivating knowledge, who are on this path of becoming perfect, that happens actually after many, many lifetimes. This mood is conveyed in verse number 7.19, where Lord says, Bahunam janmanamante gyanvan man prapadyate vasudevah sarvamiti sa mahatma sudurlabha. So this Vasudev sarvamiti realization, that Vasudev, Lord Krishna, is the ultimate absolute truth. This only comes after many, many births. Bahunam janmanamante. So like that, you can see also the mood in mantra number 15 and 16, where the prayer is about removing that bright effulgence so that I can know your face. So that is something which is knowing the personal feature of the Lord. And that is the same thing is mentioned here in 19. Vasudeva Sarvamiti. Vasudev is actually the name. And he is the Sarvamiti. He is the topmost understanding. Vasudev is the topmost understanding. That comes after only after many, many lifetimes. So then Prabhupada continues to explain that it is insufficient to know that I am spiritual. So spiritual knowledge have various levels. First level is we understand that I am not this body. I am a spirit soul. I am spiritual. I am not material. That is the first level of understanding. The second level of understanding is from where this spirit soul has come. And then the person develops this understanding that spirit soul actually has come from the Supreme Lord. We are the part and parcel of the Supreme Lord. And then the third level understanding is that we cannot become Supreme Lord, but we can become the perfect servant of the Supreme Lord, the relationship. So the full knowledge is that I am part and parcel of the Supreme Whole, the Supreme Lord, and I can never become the Supreme Whole. I can at best become the servant of the Supreme Whole. And when we have that kind of an understanding, we enter into the spiritual kingdom of the Lord. So Prabhupada, by these two paragraphs in his purport, is trying to establish the fact once again that the personal aspect of the Lord actually is the topmost aspect. And once a devotee knows that is the topmost aspect, it inspires devotion naturally. And once the devotion is inspired, when the devotion is triggered, he surrenders to the personal aspect of the Lord and not surrender to the Brahma Jyoti aspect of the Lord. In Brahma Jyoti aspect, there is no mood of surrender actually. There is actually the mood is to become one with the Brahma Jyoti. There is no mood of surrender. Surrender mood is only in the devotional part. So now Prabhupada is trying to, because this mantra is talking about death and thoughts at the time of death. Here in this mantra, the thoughts are about or the mood is, consciousness is that please remember my services. So Prabhupada is now building upon the same theme based on the discussion in Srimad Bhagavad Gita itself. So he is trying to say in this paragraph 6 to 7 that the lost thought at the time of death is very important. And he is establishing this part that on deathbed, we remember only what we practice throughout our life. Throughout our life, whatever deeds we do, whatever association we take, whatever thoughts we develop, whatever consciousness we develop, that continues at the time of death. Like you see the picture here, this person who is shown at the bottom is a lusty person, and he develops lusty kind of consciousness at the time of death. And because he develops the lusty consciousness, the next life he gets a body of a dog, where he can satisfy his lust. He can satisfy that lust by partnering with any number of she dogs. There is no foundation in the next life. Similarly, this person who is fond of eating a lot of filthy food has been given a life of a hog. Huh? Then this person who is developing more goodness, he's developing charity, he's giving charity to the brahmanas, he's giving charity to people who are spiritually minded and so on. He's a kind-hearted person. He gets a body where in the heavens, where he can enjoy a much more prolonged life, much more comfortable life and so on. But on the top has been shown a devotee who constantly develops remembrance of the Lord by offering devotional service, by offering bhakti, by offering prayers to the Lord, actually enters into the kingdom of the Lord and has a personal relationship with the Lord in the kingdom of the Lord. So like that, Prabhupada is trying to say that the last thought is very important. On deathbed, we will remember only what we practice throughout our life. We can develop love of God by practicing devotional service. This mantra actually reminds us that the Lord remember our service. But even if the Lord, even if somebody does not remind the Lord still remembers. So like that, Srila Prabhupada has developed this theme of last thought is very important. And how we can develop our last thought? We can develop that last thought right from now, right from having the right actions, devotional services, and so on. If we engage ourselves in those kind of thoughts, thinkings, we can actually moving in the right direction. We can moving in the best direction and attain the topmost destination after the end of our life. Then after, in paragraph 7, after leaving this thought that if one does not even remind the Lord, but the Lord still remembers. Here, Srila Prabhupada, in the paragraph number 8 and 9, he's telling that Krishna never forgets our service. Here, in this mantra, the devotee is trying to remind the Lord, but Prabhupada is reiterating this point that even if you don't remind, the Lord will still remember. And he is giving references from Bhagavad Gita once again. He's saying Krishna's relationship with devotee is very, very intimate. And how he is explaining that? He even forgives the Durachari. And he's saying in verse number 30 and 31 of Bhagavad Gita, chapter 9, that even if my devotee becomes Durachari, occasional fall down is there, but we should forgive such a occasional fall down. We can overlook such a occasional fall down, because by the force of the devotional service, he will soon become Dharmatma. Then in the subsequent verse number 32, Prabhupada continues to mention that even low born like Vaishyas and Shudras, they can also attain supreme destination by practice of devotional service. So devotional service is not kind of restricted to only the Brahmanas or only the top spiritually much more evolved people. No, even anyone from any walk of society, when he takes to the devotional service, can actually attain the supreme destination. So that is what through these examples, Prabhupada is trying to explain, that Krishna never forgets our service. He is very, very merciful. If we engage in the devotional service, he takes cognizance of that devotional service. And in the 9th paragraph, Srila Prabhupada actually quotes Bhakti Vinod Thakur. Now, who is Bhakti Vinod Thakur? Bhakti Vinod Thakur is actually father of Srila Bhakti Siddhant Saraswati Thakur. And from our previous classes, we know that Bhakti Siddhant Saraswati Thakur was actually the father of spiritual master of Srila Prabhupada. So Bhakti Vinod Thakur has a very prominent place in ISKCON society. In the Sankirtan movement, the way we see the Sankirtan movement today actually has been conceptualized in the very beginning, specifically by Srila Bhakti Vinod Thakur. So he's a very prominent acharya in our movement. And Prabhupada in the paragraph number 9 actually quotes Srila Bhakti Vinod Thakur and explains that how Bhakti Vinod Thakur have explained the word Durachari, and how he has explained that how even if the devotee has performed some abominable act, but still we can forgive him. So Bhaktivinod Thakur actually mentions that unless and until the bhakti part, see, there are two parts in our life, like we understood in our previous classes also in mantra number 14, if I recall, where we are talking about balancing the spiritual and the material. And mantra number 11, we talk about the same theme. So Bhaktivinod Thakur mentions here that life has two aspects. One, where the devotee actually has to take care of his material body. And the second is where the devotee has to take care of his devotional service towards the Lord. So both of these actions go together. And they are something like a railway track. Like railway track, the railway engine actually travels on both the tracks, both two lines. So he's comparing the life of a devotee that it is actually running on both the tracks, a material track as well as the devotional track. And then he continues to explain that as the devotional part in the life increases, slowly and gradually, the material aspect or taking care of the body aspect reduces. And then he finally makes this statement that unless and until the bhakti part reaches a certain point, the material aspect will continue to pull us down. So like that, he's explaining that the durachar part continues only till that point, unless and until our devotional service becomes steady, becomes strong enough, and so strong enough that we actually don't do any durachar and so on. So here in the picture that you see, I have shown Parikshit Maharaj putting up a snake, garlanding Shamik Rishi with a snake. So Parikshit Maharaj was a devotee, but because of some occasional fit of anger or whatever, he committed that offense, but later on he regretted. So we have discussed this more in elaborate detail in our other classes. Now moving to our next slide, also I would like to add this to what Srila Prabhupada has already explained, that Krishna never forgets our service. It is also very clear from two examples in the scriptures that we can see. So the two examples that we can see from the scriptures is about one example is of Draupadi and the second example is of Putana. We know that Draupadi, when she was being dishonored and disrobed by Kauravas in the assembly, Lord Krishna actually gave her unlimited sari. And there's a little background to it. One day, when Krishna and Arjuna were sitting in a room and they were talking, conversing with each other, Draupadi enters into the room with a basket of fruits. And he keeps that basket of fruit with a knife in front of Krishna. Krishna starts to peeling those fruit or cut those fruit, but accidentally the knife slips away from the hand of Krishna. And it cuts the Lord's finger. And the blood starts to come out from the finger of the Lord. Draupadi, when she sees that, she spontaneously tears apart her sari, creates a small bandage, and ties that bandage on the finger of Lord Krishna. Lord Krishna was peacefully observing out of love and affection towards Draupadi, that how she was so caring and she was so concerned about Krishna. And Krishna actually mentioned to Draupadi that I will certainly never forget that service of yours. And Krishna actually repaid that in an unlimited way by giving her unlimited sari. Now here we have understood from our previous classes that the Lord body is transcendental. It does not have blood. So some of you may ask, how come then blood came out of Lord's finger? So the answer is that Lord, in order to do that leela, do that activity, can actually enact in any way. Yeah? Lord is omnipotent. Lord is all powerful. He can do anything. So in order to create that leela, he did that kind of an activity. Similarly, we see from the example of Putana. Putana came to kill Krishna, but she came to kill Krishna in the disguise of a nurse, in the disguise of a dhai. Dhai, we call it as nurse. in English. So she tried to breastfeed Krishna. So Krishna actually did not saw any of malevolent feelings of Putana. She only took account of that she actually came to feed me as her as my mother. And when Putana was killed, Putana, the Lord gave Putana a very exalted position. She gave Putana a position of mother in the spiritual world. So like that, we can see that Lord never forgets the service. Even if we are doing some service where our fellow devotees are not taking into cognizance of whatever we are doing, our spiritual teacher does not take into cognizance of our services, whatever we are doing, but the Lord never forgets. Even little service we do for the Lord, Lord always remember our services. Then we also try to understand that Lord is very, very merciful. Lord is a ocean of love. He is ever waiting. He is ever willing. And he is ever working for our benefit. He is ever waiting means that we are, for time immemorial, we have turned our faces away from the Lord. But the Lord, situated in our heart as Paramatma, is always eagerly waiting for us, that when we turn away towards him and he actually start to guide us, he starts to instruct us. Similarly, he's ever willing. Like there might be a trouble or a difficult relationship between two friends, and a friend may fight with another friend and leave away the relationship. But Krishna is always willing to patch up. He's always ready. Only thing is, we are not always ready to move towards the Lord for that patch up. He's ever working. He's ever working means, many times when we are favored by somebody, we feel grateful for that person and we want to reciprocate. We want to return that favor. Similarly, the Lord has, since time immemorial, every time he's always working for our benefit. He's giving us air to breathe. He's giving us fruits. He's giving us grains to eat. He's doing everything for us, for our maintenance, for our livelihood and so on. He's ever working for us. But we are so ungrateful, we never look towards him. So Krishna, he's an ocean of love. He's ever waiting, ever willing and ever working. Like that, what Srila Prabhupada, or what I'm trying to convey here is that Lord is very merciful. We don't need to remind the Lord specifically for our services. We simply, even if we do a small, we take small step towards the Lord, Lord is willing to take 100 steps towards us. And this mercy is available through devotional service. So that is the next theme where Srila Prabhupada is mentioning that in the devotional service, which is 9 types of limbs are there in devotional services: Shravanam, Kirtanam, Smaranam, Pad Sevanam, Archanam, Vandanam, Dasyam, Sakyam, Atmanivedanam. And through all these, any of these processes of devotional services, we can actually have access to the same unlimited mercy of the Lord. We can see Prabhupada has given example of Shravanam, Parikshit Maharaj and Shukdev Goswami. Kirtanam, actually in the purport, Srila Prabhupada has given example of Parikshit Maharaj, but here in the picture you see Narad Muni of Kirtanam, always glorifying the Lord. Smaranam, the example is Prahlad Maharaj. Pad Sevanam, the example is Lakshmi Devi. Archanam, the example is Prithu Maharaj, who worshipped the Lord. Vandanam, the example is given of Akrura. Dasyam is Hanumanji, example serving Lord Ramchandra. Sakhyam, friendship, Arjuna and Krishna. The example is given, and Atmanivedanam. Here the example of Bali Maharaj is given, who actually surrendered everything for Lord Vamandev when he came as disguised of a dwarf Brahmana. So in these paragraphs, Prabhupada is trying to say that impersonalists do not have that mercy, do not have that excess of mercy. Why? Because the impersonalists are attached to the Brahmajyoti feature of the Lord. And this is mentioned in the 12th chapter, 5th verse of Srimad Bhagavad Gita, where the Lord says that the path of impersonalists is very, very cumbersome. So devotional service is easy. It is accessible to all. And by doing devotional service, we can easily come, develop love and develop attachment both towards the Lord and both towards the service of the Lord. So that is what Srila Prabhupada is trying to explain in this purport. Finally, Srila Prabhupada concludes all these purports by explaining that the essence of this purport is elaborated in detail in Srimad Bhagavatam. And why he is saying so? Because in Bhagavatam, what is the background? What is the context? Context is that Parikshit Maharaj has been cursed that he will die in 7 days. And Parikshit Maharaj asks this question, what is the duty of a person, especially the person who is going to die? What is the duty of that person? And the answer of that question is that one should engage in the devotional service of the Lord. So that is why Srila Prabhupada is trying to explain that the theme of this particular verse is elaborated in detail in Srimad Bhagavatam. And finally, he concludes in paragraph 13 and 15 that devotional service is the main objective, is the topmost dharma for a living entity. That is the topmost duty, especially at the time of death. And how we can perform that duty? As we discussed in the previous slide, there are 9 possible ways. But among those 9 possible ways, the top 2 ways is hearing and chanting God's glories. And you all assemble every Sunday or Saturday to hear these glories of the Supreme Lord by reading books like Ishopanishad, by reading books like Bhagavad Gita and so on. So that is very, very appreciated by all of you, to all of you. And then if we cannot do so unless practiced during one's lifetime, we cannot do hearing and chanting of the Supreme Lord at the time of our death just spontaneously. For that, we need to practice throughout our life. And if we have to practice this throughout our life, the best time is that we start now. We should not wait for any auspicious occasion to occur in the future. The best time is we should understand the urgency that it is associated with a very important milestone of our life, which is death. And why it is very milestone? Because that is going to decide our next destination. And if we want a best destination, that is the lotus feet of the Lord, we should start our devotional practice now. And we need to understand the urgency and engage in godly activities without wasting even a single second. So with that, I hope the explanation of the purport is very clear. At the beginning of the class, there was a feedback that mantra 15, 16, 17 are sounding a little difficult. I try to address that part also, try to explain mantra 17 also in that context. So I hope things are now more clear, more better now. And if there are any questions, we can take it now. So all glories to Sri Ishopanishad. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Any questions or takeaways and comments, maybe we can discuss now. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna. You can now unmute yourself and let me know your comments and feedback or any questions you might have.
Hare Krishna.
First of all, let me know, was the feedback that was received that the mantra 15, 16 were not very clear. Is that okay now? Or any doubts on that, maybe we can address that first of all and then move to questions and comments later. Manish Prabhu?
Yeah, this was clear, Prabhu. This okay. Was very simple and very clear.
Okay, but you have the appreciation of how mantra 15, 16 are connected with the larger text?
Yes.
Yeah.
Now things are clear. Maybe I will read.
Yeah, we lost your voice, Prabhu. Okay, anyway, maybe we can open it for further discussion or comments, feedback from others. Kartar Prabhuji, you were saying something?
Hare Krishna. Dandavat. Just one thing, really. You know, I understood most of the essence so easily explained. In spite of all that, when death is a next station and a spiritual meaning of death is you should go to, you're going to a, you know, next destination. Still, even I have seen all walks of lives of people, why we cry, why we make shok sabhas, why we make this. This is really hurting me from last many years. And I'm trying to find a answer. Prabhuji can help me.
Yeah, so Shok Sabha, Prabhuji, when we are separated by someone whom we love, so there is a natural tendency to express that separation by showing appropriate emotions and so on. So when a devotee is actually leaves the world, generally there is a pain that the fellow devotees experience because they miss the presence of the other devotee. But they also understand that the devotee actually has moved to a better and a higher destination, and that's why they are happy as well. So in the Vaishnava culture, if you see, you will find that these emotions at the time of death are expressed in a more appropriate way. So we do in the Vaishnava culture, you will see that the pain of separation is also expressed because we are missing very dearly. We are missing the association because this association of a devotee was purifying. So we express that loss, but at the same time we also feel happy that the devotee has moved to a better destination. Yeah, and you will see that kind of mood being reflected in all the Vedic literatures. If you read the dialogue between Bharat Maharaj and Lord Ramachandra, Lord Ramachandra also gives those kind of explanation to Bharat Maharaj. There is no need to lament and so on. In Bhagavad Gita also, you see the dialogue between Arjuna and Krishna. In Bhagavatam, you see the dialogue between Vasudev and Kamsa, like that. So it is in that understanding the emotions are expressed in the Vedic culture. Yeah,
it's my personal experience. Mm-hmm. You know, I have seen in this life of 78 so many, you know, deaths. So knowing all this from childhood and getting good lessons from people like you, mm-hmm. it's my good chance. But still, sometimes spontaneously you feel like, you know, it's as if it's that time, you know, that the guy, the person or the Jivatma or the Atma is going to the destination for the next better life. Mm-hmm. But still, spontaneously feel like shedding tears and sometime even cry. Mm-hmm. So, I don't know. It means that our understanding is not still mature.
People may shed tears without knowing the permanent nature of the spirit soul also. And also, at the same time, we may not have really developed that kind of a spiritual vision so far in our devotional life. We are practicing devotees. We are not advanced devotees or pure devotees. We are practicing devotees. So as practicing devotees, we still have those material tendencies and so on. And under the influence of those material tendencies, we may express those emotions. So that is how I can explain that. Yeah. Like Arjuna was doing. Arjuna was doing. Arjuna was also having similar emotions towards his relatives. But Arjuna's emotions, like Prabhupada mentioned in his purport, that the way Arjuna was showing his emotions was actually showing his devotional heart. That he was so much considerate about the well-being of the others that he was thinking of even relinquishing his duty. So like that, after guidance from the Lord, he understands. But there are few others like Duryodhana, even after guidance from the Lord, they never understood.
He never understood. Yeah. Thank you, Guruji, for making things clear.
Thank you, Prabhuji.
Dandavat,
Prabhuji. Hare Krishna. So any other remarks, questions?
Thank you, Prabhu. It was very nice. Today's class, I understand very easily, Prabhu.
Okay, Mataji. Thank you very much for that feedback.
And one more thing, a same question I want to ask. Our own people only, if they are not, understand, and they don't take away our spirituality, like, in that case, what we have to do, Prabhu?
Yeah, Mataji, we need to they understand. Yeah, so as devotees, we need to understand how the mindset of others, the mindset of materialists, we understand. So we behave appropriately. Yes. We behave appropriately. Yeah. If they, we don't have to impose ourselves on the others. We don't have to force our thoughts, our beliefs, faiths on others. We have to kind-hearted with somebody who has faced this loss. In case somebody has lost some near and dear one. So at that time, we don't go and tell them that, why are you lamenting? This is not the body, this is a spirit soul, the soul doesn't die and so on. So we don't start to speak philosophy to that person. So as devotees, we need to be sensitive enough to bring these things or bring these topics to at the right time. So we don't create distress among the distressed. Rather, we create some kind of a soothing balm if somebody is feeling distressed. So we can help them by holding their hand, by expressing that our sympathy, that I cannot experience the grief that you are going through, and maybe I can offer my hand, I can offer my shoulder, and whatever I can do for you at this moment of time, in this moment of great grief for you. So like that, we try to be a friend to them at that time. And later on, when they are more composed, more calm, and the atmosphere is conducive, and you have a relationship like that with the other person. Yeah, relationship means that if you are going to tell him something more spiritual, more philosophical, the person is willing to listen to you. So like that, we have to take into account a lot of things when we are dealing with outside world. And something which we will discuss more in our coming classes, when we talk about topics in Nectar of Instruction, Upadesha Amrit, where we are dealing mainly about the relationship with the devotees and so on. We will discuss this more in that section of our discussion. Yeah.
Thank you, Prabhu. Very nicely explained.
Thank you, Mataji. Yeah.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Yes.
Though it may appear a little hair splitting, but I want to know the sacrificial aspect of devotional service, because this word is very frequently used, sacrifices. So who is doing sacrifice and who is enjoying the sacrifice, the God or the devotee or both of them? And what exactly is sacrifice means in devotional service?
Sacrifice means, Prabhu, the activities we do for others. Bhoga okay, means enjoying. Okay. Enjoying, the opposite of okay. Sacrifice is bhoga or enjoying.
Okay, okay.
So enjoying is something for ourselves. When we are enjoying our senses, when we are okay. Enjoying our senses, that is something which is called bhoga. And when we are serving,
restricting ourselves, then it is sacrifice.
When we are trying to serve others, and the supreme service is that we serve the okay. Supreme Lord. Like for example, okay. when we chant Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, it is a sacrifice. We are sacrificing our time. We are sacrificing our energy.
True.
We are sacrificing True. Our attention. We are sacrificing our consciousness yes. to focus on the Lord. So that is something which is known as sacrifice. And enjoyment means I am great. I am the best. That is something which which is enjoying, which is bhoga.
Even if the devotee is being rewarded so much, even then it is also considered a sacrifice, because chanting means you are coming close to the Lord. So I think we can reduce this burden of sacrifice. I think a better word should be, can't it be something better? Because God is returning so much, giving us, He is promising us to give us so much.
Yeah, so the sacrifice word has the word sacrifice has some feeling of pain. Some feeling of separation.
That is what I wanted to.
That is why we call it devotional service. Now, devotional service can be done whenever we do some service for others, that can be done at four motivational levels. Four motivational levels means out of fear, out of reward, out of feeling of reward.
Yes.
The third is out of duty. yes, and the fourth yes. is out of love. So even right. if we do devotional service at the level of fear and something in expectation of reward, then also Lord takes into account right. our devotional service. He doesn't reject it. Okay. Like we see in Bhagavad Gita, okay. Artho, Artharto, Jigyasi, Jnani, we had four kind of right. devotees. But at the minimum, we should act at a level of duty, kartavya, that the Lord has right. done so much for us. At least we should spend some time during the day towards the service of the Lord.
Right.
That much we should do. Right. And later on, by this practice, by regular praying, the Lord will have mercy. And Lord will give us the intelligence. Yes, Lord will give us this realization that we should do this spontaneously. We will discuss all these topics about devotees and devotional service more in our next book, Upadeshamrita,
right,
where you will
right,
where we will discuss in detail about relationship with the
right,
Lord,
right.
relationship with the devotees, what are the various levels, how we can work, how devotional service actually grows slowly and gradually, what are various levels.
Yes,
we will discuss in our...
Yes, we are looking forward to, yes.
Yeah,
yes,
after maybe 2-3 classes, we will come to that topic. Yeah.
Right. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Prabhuji. Hare Krishna. So
any Hare other, Krishna.
Yeah, any other, maybe last question we can take now? Or any comment or remark? Okay, I consider this silence to be that there is no question and no remarks. So I really express my gratitude to everyone. Thank you very much for sparing your time and listening to the discourse. So we will get together once again for our final concluding words on Ishopanishad. It has been a long journey, 25 classes, and you have been very, very patient. Thank you very much. And let us meet next time with mantra number 18 on Ishopanishad in the next class. Thank you.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Thank you.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna Prabhu.
Hare Krishna Prabhu.
Thank you. Hare Krishna Venkoba Prabhu. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Krishna.